Hi, I'm Chuck Huber for Stata Corp, and welcome to another Stata Happy Hour. We are broadcasting a little bit early today because our guest is joining us from London. So it's 5 o'clock in London, but it's 11 o'clock here at Stata Corp. So our guest today, by the way, if you have questions for our guest, please just type them in the comments on whatever platform you're using, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or whatever. We'll get your questions either way and try and answer as many of those as we can. So my guest today is Professor Stephen Jenkins. Professor Jenkins is Professor of Economic and Social Policy in the Department of Social Policy at the London School of Economics and Political Science. He's author of several books, including Inequality and Poverty Reexamined in 2007, Changing Fortunes, Income Mobility and Poverty Dynamics in Britain from 2011, The Great Recession and the Distribution of Household Income in 2013, and I would like to point out that our Stephen Jenkins today is not the lead singer of the band Third Eye Blind. So welcome, Professor Jenkins. It's so nice to see you today.
Hi there. Great. Great to be here. Maybe I should have been in a band.
Sure. When I was doing my research to...
I'm in a choir, but that's a bit different.
You sing it differently?
I sing in a choir. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Well, yeah, maybe you should audition, and they wouldn't even have to change the name. So, I usually start with the same question for everyone, and because the stories are always so interesting, and people seem to enjoy them. I know I enjoy them. Which is, if you ask little kids what they want to be when they grow up, they never say I want to be a professor of economics or statistics. They say things like I want to be a firefighter or a ballerina. So, how did you find your way to a career as an academic economist or policy person? We'll come back to exactly what you do later, but how did you find your way into your career?
A sequence of happy accidents, I think, is the answer, and taking up opportunities. I'm the sort of guy who, I'm afraid, left secondary school, went to university not knowing what he would do, so he took the broadest degree you could, which was a Bachelor of Arts combined with an undergraduate law degree. I did English, I did economics, I did first year mathematics, and I did introduction to law. And I sort of carried on like that and ended up dropping the law because I found some of it pretty boring. I got a good mark in economics, so I kept on with economics, and then, but I also maintain I do have a major in English. So my wife tells me I don't actually appear to have learned anything from it. But and then I had no idea what to do after that, and I'd always wanted to travel, so I thought maybe PhD. And after a year or 10 months at one of New Zealand's universities, headed off to the University of York, UK. I did the first year of the coursework in the PhD program there, and still not knowing exactly what I would do, but did well in the coursework, but spent my life saving. So I then had to decide what to do. And the answer was get a job. And that job was to be a researcher on a project that was different from my then PhD topic. And happenstance was that the project was, which was about one of the first data project looking at the inheritance of income across generations, using a unique data source for the UK. It was supervised by a guy, Atkinson, who's a giant in the field. And, after the year, I made the salary last a couple of years so I could live off it. I returned to my thesis time, and I was very lucky that Tony offered to be my doctoral supervisor. And in a way, the rest is history, apart from, you know, the hassles of getting a job after finishing your PhD, that sort of thing. And here I am, after having met people, got into the UK job system, and so on.
So I didn't realize that you were born and grew up in New Zealand. I didn't know that until I was doing my research on you. What was that like growing up in New Zealand? Did you, it never even occurred to you, I guess, to pursue an academic career?
I think like most kids, when you're growing up, you have no idea that there are people out there as academics. Let me illustrate it. When my parents came to visit me when I was working at the University of Bath in the mid-80s, I took them into my office and showed them around. And they understand what teaching is, but they turned, my father turned to me and said, but what do you actually do? And I think there's a problem, you know. I talk to the neighbors and they say, so well, you've got all those holidays. And so the idea of people doing research is quite hard to communicate, I think. Yeah. Teaching is easy, but it's all the other stuff.
People understand the teaching part pretty well.
Yeah.
I think they wonder why we don't do it more, though. Academics, I mean.
What, so, do more teaching or more communication?
More teaching. I think they wonder, well, what? You only teach one class. What do you do the rest of the time?
They'd get it in the ear from me. I'm afraid our teaching loads are rather higher than one class, and I've taken on a few administrative roles. The other thing that people do is when you tell them you've been a head of department and managing, you know, being a manager or administrator, they understand that. But research is still a bit elusive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not something that most people are exposed to unless they're in academia, academic research. So what led you to move to the UK? Was it just the academic opportunities, or why the UK? Why not the United States? Was there something special about the UK, or did you have another connection there? Or
That's a very good point. Well, you know, New Zealand is a small place a long way away. And if you don't have a tradition of academic background, you don't really know what to do. I knew North America versus the UK. And in the end, there were two things that swung it. One, at my undergraduate university, we'd had a visit from somebody from the University of York who was incredibly friendly and welcoming. And in fact, he became my mentor when I did go to York, first of all. And the second thing is, I'm afraid I've actually got a British passport as well as my New Zealand passport, because my father was born about 10 miles away from where I'm currently living a long time ago. Though the funny thing is, his mother was born in Auckland, New Zealand. So I've never been able to work out what there is, you know, this piece of elastic between the two countries. But yeah, so there was a natural UK connection. In a way,
like salmon spawning up a river or something to return to your birthplace, or
my wife, who's definitely very, very British or English, teases me about, you know, I've been in the UK now for 40 years and but I still identify as a New Zealander, so she questions that sometimes. I think your identity is, you can have multiple identities,
Well, speaking of identities, I was looking over your website and you describe yourself, this is your description on your website, you describe yourself as a quantitative generalist. I always think of you as sort of an economist or statistician. How would you describe a quantitative generalist? What is that?
Well, it was, to be honest, it was an insult, a near insult that was thrown at me by one of my former professors when I was a junior academic. During my career, I've only worked in a mainstream economics department for a relatively short period of time. The other ones I've been in social policy groups, which are multidisciplinary. And this guy, Rudolf Klein, once was questioning, I think, my social policy credentials. He was a professor of social policy, definitely not an economist, and just sort of spat out that I was just a quantitative generalist. So I just sort of assumed, as you know, sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me. And I've sort of liked it as an idea as I've moved through most of my career. I worked in a multidisciplinary research institute for 16, 17 years at Essex. So, you know, and the department I'm in is social policy now, which has a few economists, but where are people from other disciplines. So quantitative generalist, you know, is a useful label where among some people who think, economists are from hell. And, well, sometimes some of those people think that the quantitative researchers are from hell as well. But I think it's a nice badge, and it works well, I think, within, for example, the Stata community. You know, I am quantitative, and my interests are incredibly wide. You know, this, there's so much of interest out there. And one of the great things about the Stata community for me, which has been since the a long time now, is being able to meet people from all around the world, multiple disciplines. You know, it's a great feedback exercise, if you will, and I hope it works both ways.
Yes. So yeah, you may as well put it on as a badge of honor, right?
Yeah.
So exactly. I'm curious. You've edited two books. Correct me if I'm wrong on these, but it looks like you've edited two books and written three books. Does that desire to write books stem from your English background, your training in English, or do you just enjoy writing about quantitative topics and things?
It's a mixture of both. I mean, I have been an academic for, you know, most of my career, apart from, you know, holiday jobs as a rubbish truck collector, driver, and so on. But books within academic career, most people turn their noses down at them, certainly in mainstream economics. But at a couple of points, so there were two. So the first one, you edited volume referred to Inequality and Poverty Reexamined, was a festschrift in honor of Tony Atkinson. Before he died, but did pull together lots of timely stuff. As it happened, we had contributions from all the people who were Tony's PhD students at around about a particular time. So there's lots of happy coincidences there, as well as being academically worthwhile, I should say. The Great Recession book, my Italian colleague Andrea Brandolini approached me and John Wickwright, Brian Nolan. Clearly, that was it was a big crisis. And Andrea, who works for the Banca d'Italia, the central bank of Italy, you know, said, let's do something. And in fact, it's a book that came out of a big report that we wrote for an Italian organization. Yeah. And then thirdly, rather differently, the sole authored book, the Changing Fortunes one, was really... It was time to consolidate my research on a decade or so of looking at income mobility, how people's incomes change between one year and the next. Sometimes referred to as income mobility, but also poverty in the system. It's articles and Stata ado.
Lots and lots of articles. And of course, Stata ado files. So how did you come across Stata? How did you start using Stata? Because you've had a long, we'll talk about your career with Stata or your contributions to Stata as we go, but how did you first discover Stata?
Well, I think I owe it to a guy, Ian Walker. They were who you worked together at the time, but moving between a lot of software in my career, which I can tell you about a bit. Ian, who applied my microeconometrician, said, hey, have you heard of it? At that time, the particular thing that he said was, did you know that it did all sorts of things like survival analysis? But in fact, you know, I started as an economist, MSc, using TSP, feeding cards into a machine. That'll tell you how old I am. Punch cards. My research jobs. I first learned SPSS. Later, I got into BMD because that had you could do Cox models in BMDP at the time. Nowhere else. I got into Gauss because don't ask me now. God, that was hard work. And that didn't last long. That was software for a task, and the fact that you had to pay for anything that was useful was difficult for me. And then the best thing that came along after that was something by Dubin and Rivers called SST, statisticals. I don't know if it's still around. I think it was a really nice piece of work because it had discrete statistics, and it also had survival analysis. I was interested in at the time. But then early 90s or so, I think version 2.1 was the first for me. And then, frankly, have used anything else. because, you know, I'm a big data guy. I think the importance of data is forgotten by a lot of analysts and both data, you know, data management, data organization, and the graphical tools that are really good for that, as well as, an expanding set of estimation, you know, stuff that the final bit at the end, people who do econometrics courses often come out and they learn about the last 1% putting, you know, typing reg, whereas there's a lot of important stuff before that. Stata does it for me. That's essentially why I stuck with it for pretty much everything.
Yeah, so you're not just a typical Stata user. You're heavily involved in the Stata community. You're an associate editor of the Stata Journal. I met you for years ago before I worked at Stata Corp at the UK meeting, which I always associate you with. You've been an organizer for many, many years of the UK meeting. And I went back and looked because I wanted to see, were you at my understanding is the first Stata user group meeting was held in London in 1997. Now I went back and looked, you did two talks at the UK meeting in 1998. But were you at the very first meeting in 1997?
Gee, I can't remember. I looked on my CV. I couldn't find it. I would have probably mentioned it.
Okay.
I know my first, the state of technical stuff, bulletin stuff was round about that time. But the first one I co-organized was in 1999 with Bianca de Stavola, who's a very eminent medical statistician. A biostatistician, and that represents what Stata is for me, you know, two disciplines getting together, and that's continued over the whole time. So now I've been doing it with most recently with Roger Newson and Michael Crowther, you know, I mean, the biostats, and it's great. I think the communities interact.
Oh, they're tremendous fun. For those people out there who've never been to one, you should check one out, either in the country closest to you or lately we've been doing them online, so they're easy to visit, even if you're far, far away from the location. So how did the first user group meetings come about? Because the earliest one started actually in London, not in the UK, not in the United States. How did those early meetings come about, and what were they like?
Well, it was Bill Gould, it's all down to Anna Timberlake. Those of you who may not know that Timberlake Consultants are the UK distributors of Stata. They also do Portugal as well. Anna Timberlake was Portuguese, and her daughter and husband are now running the company. But Anna had this inspired idea of getting together, I think. She was certainly responsible for the idea of wishes and grumbles sessions at the end of each user group meeting, which is, for those of you who haven't been to one, they're essentially where all the Stata Corp people who come along, and London is lucky that we've had a good turnout for virtually all the time I've been going. Is that users can, after a short update report from Stata Corp, we say, why can't we have X? Or please, can we have Y? Or, and so on. As I've written somewhere else, I think one of the great things, visions about Stata is this relative openness. It shows up in, you know, the ado files, you know, for many of those. Willingness to listen. It's great.
So how have the meetings changed over the years? My assumption, I wasn't at those early meetings. I didn't go back in the late 90s. I've been using Stata since I think around 96, but I'm assuming those meetings have changed a lot over the years. They seem much more sort of organized. Not that the early ones were disorganized, but my guess is that they were probably more informal, a bit smaller? How have they changed over the years, do you think? Because you've been an organizer for 20 years now.
It doesn't feel that they've changed dramatically. I mean, the constant mm-hmm. has been there's a core of people who've been along to lot, and there are new faces, and that's really important as well. We've had the Stata Corp people coming along as sort of vote of confidence. That's very good. I think numbers are now twice, you know, we're essentially getting twice as many people. And there is, you know, and so perhaps as we're all growing older together, I mean, there is more of a sense, so to speak, there is a sense of, you know, the community out there.
Yeah.
Can be good. It does actually that it's changed a lot, apart from, you know, IT sort of stuff that's changed. You know, we're no longer dumping acetate down on a projector or projecting and things like that. Yeah,
it's amazing. There are user groups now, and I've been to user group meetings in Japan. I haven't been to the Chinese user group meeting, but they have them in China now, as well as countries in South America and Australia. I've been to the Australian meeting. It's just amazing how the user group meetings have grown over the years. They're in most major parts of the world now. So do you have any advice for young econometricians or economists and statisticians coming up? Things you would recommend or things like that?
Well, it partly depends on their track. And I'm afraid economists are also people trying to get into, for example, academic jobs in economics, econometrics. I'm afraid there are certain criteria that the profession sort of assumes about people, and many of the sorts of things I've been talking about, I think about sorts of things that are valued highly in the Stata community, shall we say, are not valued quite as highly in that job market. So I think the first piece of advice is get an idea of where you want to go, and you'll have to adapt that. The second piece of advice that goes along with it, however, is to point out that I hope that I can be proof positive that you don't have to, if you're an economist, you don't have to work in a mainstream and yet have a productive and happy career and meet lots of nice people along the way.
Yeah, it's amazing that it's funny. The economic general, or the research generalist? I wrote it, quantitative generalist title. You know, that was used as a slur a while back, but now that's something that's encouraged. Multidisciplinary teams and multidisciplinary departments and things. So,
Sure, and I guess data scientist might sound like a generic label as well, though I think that's to some extent taken over by that new area by the computer scientists and the methodologists and the big data people.
Yeah. So I guess I'll put you on the spot. So I have a question for you. So you've edited two books and written three books. Any plans to write a Stata Press book about Stata? You've been associated with Stata for many, many years. Have you ever thought about writing a book for Stata Press?
Thank you, Chuck. Thank you for the question. There are, let me just say, a former colleague used to talk to me, perhaps be even more blunt about the questions. Let's say that there are two books potentially inside me that could potentially be Stata Press books. One is a book on survival analysis. Some people may know that I have a website on survival analysis, which essentially hasn't been updated since 2005. But if you look at my Google Scholar profile, it's pretty high on downloads. There's stuff I continue to teach short courses every so often on in that area, and I've got a lot of extra material. Yeah. So there's and so I think there's still room out there for a book that, you know, is more hands on. And the second one is an inequality related book, or more generally an income distribution book. That would be, you know, there are lots of introductions to and surveys of, and I've written some of them myself, but there's the hands-on stuff is not there. And Philippe Van Kerm and Ben Yan and I have talked about potentially doing it together, but we're all very busy people. And so again, that's one for a bit further down the track. I mean, and the other issue is that we each have got your emphasis. I mean, I teach this stuff again in terms of consolidation sometime.
Yeah, that would be fun. I'd look forward to that if it was in the cards. So we have a question from
Buy me out for a year. Okay.
Yeah. Isn't that's the problem? Is writing takes a lot of time and editing takes a lot of time. So if only there were more hours in the day. So we have a question from Facebook. Oops. Oh, I just lost the bottom of it. But someone asked a question about data science. You mentioned data science earlier. Do you think that's something that should be in the economist toolbox? Is that something that economic students and econometricians should be learning or focusing on?
Well, I think certainly some programs that are doing it. And, for example, Susan Athey and other people, big-name econometricians, are getting into this sort of stuff. So again, I mean, econometrics is such a big area from, you know, across macroeconometrics, microeconometrics. Yeah, there's lots of stuff that could be there. But, you know, the most important thing I think is, again, about big data is the same issue that you have with any other data set. Are they fit for purpose? Just because they're big doesn't make them better necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, well, I see we're bumping up against time here, so I'll wrap things up. But thank you again so much for joining us today and spending some time with us. And enjoy your happy hour there. It's 5:30 there, but we're still having our cup of tea here in the United States. So. Okay, thanks again.
Cheers.
Cheers. Bye-bye.
Pleasure to be here. Bye.
Bye.